He's the man behind some of the catchiest earworms of our time, enduring hits that fans around the world know by heart. It's been 50 years since Lionel Richie struck a chord with audiences, and now he's receiving a huge honour. He reflects on his brilliant career with our CBS colleague, Kelefah Sanneh.
Are they going to let me in? Are you kidding?
Oh, what a Steinway.
I think one of us should have a seat.
Well, you know what? I'll take that honour, thank you.
Even when playing composer George Gershwin's piano in Washington's Library of Congress, for Lionel Richie, performing comes naturally.
So cool to be in this building. They got all these writers up here, Aristotle, Hugo, Richie.
I like the way that sounds. Although you must admit, I mean, this is slightly overwhelming.
Richie is being awarded the library's Gershwin Prize for Lifetime Achievement.
You're here not as a tourist, you're being inducted.
I keep thinking of Tuskegee, Alabama. Mm-hmm. That's where it started.
Born in Tuskegee in 1949, Richie has been a worldwide superstar for some 50 years. First as one of the Commodores. Then as a solo artist.
Now you put it right here for good luck, darling.
I sure will.
Now as a judge on American Idol. Still, Lionel Brockman Richie Jr. says his worldview was formed on the campus of Tuskegee University, with his parents, Lionel Sr., a U.S. Army systems analyst, and Alberta Foster, a teacher.
When did you first realize how unusual your childhood was?
Now, remember now, this is in the middle of the 50s, 60s, right. You know, right in the middle of the storm of civil rights. And we were these kids growing up on a college campus with everything available to us. That's the Tuskegee Airmen over there.
World War II heroes.
World War II heroes.
Just walking around.
But you didn't realize they couldn't vote.
He says the campus was his protective bubble.
We just thought that was a normal thing. Doctors, lawyers, PhDs.
All black.
All black. And we didn't realize that was because of segregation. Mm. There was no place else for them to go where black people could thrive.
Of course, Richie had his own idea of success.
For you, growing up surrounded by black lawyers, black doctors, black war heroes, and you decide to form a funk band.
This was disastrous. You have to understand. You have to understand. To walk into my family home and say to my mom, dad, grandma, yeah, I joined this band, the Commodores, we're the Black Beatles. And my poor grandmother, mom and dad almost had a nervous breakdown. And then from the community, you could see everyone passing going, oh, there's poor Lionel. Poor misguided Lionel.
He didn't seem misguided for long. He and the Commodores quickly signed to Motown Records, and in 1971, they toured as the opening act for the Jackson 5, led by Michael Jackson.
Michael and I, he's about this tall, mm-hmm. And he said, oh my God, Lionel, we sold out Madison Square Gardens. And I said, no, you sold out Madison Square Gardens.
You once, twice, three times a lady.
Richie, who started as backup, became the Commodore's lead singer and songwriter.
Three Times a Lady was the game changer, a number one song around the world. And it was the most unlikely song because remember now, funk was king, and I, of all things, write a waltz. Once, twice, and I'm thinking, oh my God.
That's a song that changed not only the size of your fan base, but maybe also the complexion of your fan base.
The massive crossover meant everybody wanted to see us.
But people sometimes use that word crossover like it's a bad thing. How did you think about crossing over?
I had a big problem with it because...
A problem with the term
with
crossover.
With the term crossover because someone asked me a question one day, Lionel, how does it feel that you've left your roots? And I said, did you ask that to the Beatles? Did you ask that to the Rolling Stones? Everyone came over to borrow from us, but I can't go that way.
In 1982, Lionel Richie went solo. The next year, he released Can't Slow Down, which won the Grammy for Best Album.
God bless you, and to my fans, I love you. Thank you.
I looked up to see who the competition was that year. Bruce Springsteen, born in the USA, Prince, Purple Rain, Tina Turner, Private Dancer, and Cyndi Lauper, She's So Unusual.
So I can leave that. I can leave right now. I dropped the mic.
Stuck on you. Got this feeling down deep in my soul that I just can't do.
The hits included Stuck on You.
Hello.
Hello.
Is it me you're looking for all night long?
And one of my favorite songs of all time.
Well, my friends, the time has come. I've got Karamu, Fiesta. Come on and sing along.
All Night Long. It's a multilingual song, sort of.
I called a friend of mine in Jamaica and I said, listen, when Bob Marley says, Woje, my boje, na boje, what is he saying? And he said, absolutely nothing, man. It doesn't mean anything. So I went back and I wrote, Tambalite said the moya. Yeah, jumbo jumbo, with the pate, oh, we're going. Of course, it means absolutely nothing.
And then, at the height of his success, he took a break.
My father said, I'm not feeling well. Would you come check this out? Now, nothing would have stopped me, except that was a dad moment.
Lionel Richie Sr. died in 1990 with his son by his side.
It gave me an opportunity to kind of take a look over my shoulder just a little bit to see where I was in altitude. And it was frightening.
His father's death, he says, changed his perspective.
I became so nostalgic. I was famous, recognized around the world, but I missed all the Christmases and the New Year's.
I've been alone with you inside my mind.
These days, Lionel Richie works at his own pace. It's now been 13 years since your last album of all new songs.
That's crazy, right?
How much longer will your fans have to wait?
The answer is, it will be this year, I promise.
Hello.
A new generation of fans sees him on American Idol and on social media, although he's less popular there than his influencer daughters, Nicole and Sophia.
Do they give you advice about how to navigate this new kind of celebrity that exists now?
Yes.
But do you take it?
Yes, I do. Believe it or not, I do.
Been a performer, judge, mentor, dad, grandpa, award recipient. What's your favorite role?
Just being Lionel Richie. Although I will tell you, of all of those, the one that has taught me the greatest lessons in the world is dad. But overall, the journey of Lionel Richie, if I may speak of myself in third party, you know, the whole adventure is just an amazing ride.